When the music fades, all is stripped away, and I simply come, longing just to bring something that's of worth, that will bless your heart. For a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear. You're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all.
Into my heart.
Jesus, yes, you are. You're looking into my heart, oh, into my heart. Oh, I'm coming back to heart of worship. It's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made. It's all about you. It's all about.
I said, lift it up from your heart to him.
And I'm coming back to the heart of. Jesus, you came into the world and you died on the cross and you bore my sin and shame. Not just so that I would sing a song for you, but so that I would live my life with you and for you and one with your heart of a father. I want to think what you're thinking. I want to know the depths of your heart, Jesus. It's what your blood paid for. Jesus, thank you for your amazing love.
Overcome by your presence, love.
sing it to him from your heart.
Your presence, Lord, that's it. Your presence, Lord. Oh, your presence, Lord. Jesus, your presence, Lord. Oh, let us become aware. Let us become more aware of your presence.
Feel the Holy Spirit here tonight. Isn't he amazing? His presence is life changing. It's life changing. And I think sometimes we can make the mistake of in these atmospheres to think, or the temptation to think, man, I've got to get all I can out of God now. I've got to have my moment with the Holy Spirit now, because I don't know if it's going to be the same when I get in my car. Or I don't know if it'll be the same when I get home tonight and lay my head down on my pillow. It's almost like we forget that what the blood of Jesus paid for wasn't just our forgiveness of sins. How many of you are thankful that your sins are forgiven by Jesus? Come on. God wants us to rejoice every day that we're forgiven, that we're set free, that we are the righteousness of God in Christ. By the blood of Jesus, not by anything good that we've done, not because we deserve it, but because the precious blood of the Lamb of God, Jesus, was shed for your sin and for mine. But forgiveness is the beginning. It's only part of the gospel. There's a whole nother part of the gospel, and the Bible calls it sanctification. It's a big word. It just means becoming more like Jesus. We say in church that you can be transformed. The Bible talks about transformation, that your whole life can change. Not just that we're forgiven and made clean, but now, supernaturally, the same presence of God that we feel tonight, he wants to live and abide in you. Jesus said when he walked the earth, he said, if you tear down this temple, I will raise it back up in 3 days. The Pharisees and the disciples thought Jesus was talking about the physical building. It says later on, when Jesus was crucified and then resurrected 3 days later, then the light bulb went off and they understood. Jesus wasn't talking about a building. Jesus said the temple of the living God is not a building. The temple of the living God is not a place. But the Bible says that God, that you, Paul said, do you not know you are the habitation and the dwelling place, the house of God? That the same Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead abides inside of you if you believe in him. Now, you may not feel a thing right now, but it's not about feeling. The Bible doesn't say that we're called to walk by feeling, but we're called to walk by faith. Now, here's the cool part. Feelings are involved in love. Imagine if you're in a relationship with somebody that never shared their feelings or showed emotion. That would be like being married or in a relationship with a wall, right? It just wouldn't work out, would it? So emotions, God wants to sanctify our emotions. He wants to speak to us and touch our emotions and heal our emotions. And he even wants us to feel him like we do tonight. But he doesn't want our love commitment to him to be based on a feeling. God wants our love commitment to him to be based on a knowing. And the knowing of God's love, the Bible says, faith comes by hearing, hearing by the word of God. Our faith isn't a blind faith. The faith we have in Jesus. It's not crossing our fingers behind our back and, God, I just pray, I just hope that this day is going to work out, you know? That's what some atheists think Christians have, is blind faith. But that's not what the Bible calls faith. The Bible says that our faith is founded on all of the promises of God in Jesus for you and me. You may be seated for a second. Rest your legs. I know we're all still full from Thanksgiving. Anybody still full from Thanksgiving? Man, my mom makes pies, y'all. She makes pies, as you can tell. Buttermilk, pecan pie. I'm drifting. Lord Jesus, help me. But faith that we have in Jesus, it's not a feeling. It's based on the Word of God. And the Bible says that all the promises of God, everything in your Bible, all the promises are for life and godliness. Everybody say life. That means life in your body, healing from every disease, healing in your mind, healing in the chemical stuff going on in your mind, healing in your body. And the second is godliness. Everybody say godliness. That just means becoming like God. Becoming Christ-like. You know, the Bible says your destiny, you were predestined before the foundation of the world to be conformed to the image of the Son. That's God's destiny for you. Sometimes it's easy for me to forget that because I'm so familiar with all my failures, so familiar with all my shortcomings and my mistakes that I forget that Jesus' destiny for me is to look like him. And sometimes because the love of God, if the love of God is just a mystery, I know the love of God is mysterious, but if the love of God is just a mystery to me and I don't know why Jesus came, then I'll never be able to aspire to be like him, and I'll just always be mystified saying things like, God, I don't know how you can love me. And so because of that, I'll just be mystified and I'll never be changed. But when I know why God loves me so much and understand why he sent his son, then the Holy Spirit awakens in me a desire, a hunger for righteousness. Righteousness is Christ-likeness. It's becoming like him. Jesus said it this way. He said, I only do what I see my Father do, and I only say what I hear my Father say. You know, another way of saying that, everything you do and everything we say comes from how we think. Every word you speak, before you said it, there was a thought to say it. Every action you do comes from a thought. So you could say this, Jesus basically said, I only think about what my Father is thinking about. If you get this, it'll change your whole life. See, the enemy, he doesn't want me to understand this about the gospel, that the blood of Jesus and the Holy Spirit have made available to me the mind of God. The Bible calls it the mind of Christ. It's available to you through relationship with God. How many of you have your Bible with you, either on your phone or a physical Bible? Your Bible, I was reading the Word of God recently, and I was talking with the Holy Spirit, and I heard the Holy Spirit say something to me. He said, Leland, the Word of God, when you hear that phrase, the Word of God, because I'm a church kid, and I grew up in church my whole life, I was pretty much born under a pew, you know? I was just in church from my birth. I was in every Easter play. I played every role. One year I was a demon. The next year I was an angel. I did it all. But because I've grown up in church, when I hear the phrase, the Word of God, I tend to think my first thought is preacher standing on a platform with a big Bible preaching. And the Holy Spirit said, Leland, my word, it's not just an ideology or a theology. My word is my thought life. You could call your Bible the thoughts of God. Are you ready? I could prove it to you using the Bible. The Bible says that all of the scripture, all of the word of God, is breathed by the Holy Spirit. Meaning, someone was there and they had this amazing moment supernaturally, and God spoke through them as they were writing. So it's breathed by the Holy Spirit. That's why it's perfect. But here's the crazy part. The Bible says no one knows the thoughts of a man except the spirit inside of the man. In the same way, no one knows the thoughts of God except the Spirit of God. And it says the Spirit searches out the depths and the mysteries of the mind of God and reveals them to us. I don't know if you heard that one, but the Holy Spirit searches out the depths of the mind and the mysteries of the heart of God, and He wants to reveal them to you. Meaning, He wants to take your imagination and your thought life and unify it and marry it to God's imagination and God's thought life. You see, the enemy, if he had to pick or choose, if he had to pick or choose between me leading worship and singing songs of worship, or me working at Starbucks full-time, praise God for Starbucks. Anybody work at Starbucks in here? My wife worked at Starbucks for forever. She knows all the drinks. She's an epic barista. But if the enemy could choose between me doing this right now, preaching and singing, but not understanding that my thoughts are the root of everything that I do and say, and just allow my thoughts to roam all over the planet Monday through Saturday, and then Sunday sing songs, but never be any real change in my life, because my mind hasn't been renewed. The enemy would rather I do that and sing for thousands of people than for me to understand that the Holy Spirit wants to renew my mind and take my thought life and marry it to God's thoughts. You see, it's not my thoughts that change me. It's God's thoughts that change me. It's not my thoughts that bring hope and life, me in and of myself. It's the thoughts of God that change the way I see myself, the way I see my family, the way I see my city, my circumstances. God's thoughts God's word is what changes me. Peter said it this way. He said, Lord, where do we go? You have the words of life. God's thoughts are full of life for you. The Bible says in Jeremiah 29:11, God said, I know the thoughts that I have for you, says the Lord. Plans to give you a future and a hope. Plans that you would prosper and not fail. That you would live and not die. That's God's purpose and destiny for you. See, that's why it's God's thoughts that bring hope and life, not ours. So I want to leave you with something. Can I leave you with something really practical? Is that okay? When me and my wife got married, my precious wife, my wife's name is Mandy. We've been married for 11 years. We got married. Yeah, come on. It's awesome. We got married when we were 19 and 18. Yeah, getting married in our house. Everybody gets married young in our family. Marry them off young. Me and my wife met when we were 15 and 14, but dating in my house was like dating in a communist country. It was really hard to date. My mom had the house on lockdown, you know? So how many of you have those moms? Anybody got those moms in here? You got a good mom if you got one of those moms. She said, this is not your room, this is my room. This is not your internet bill, this is my internet. This is not your email. This is my email. I had a great mom. She was all up in my business, which is good. She kept me on the straight and narrow. So me and my wife got married really young. We got married in 19 and 18. So we were madly in love with one another, but there was a lot of things that we were dealing with, and we didn't know how to express them to one another because we were so young. And 4 years into our marriage, all of a sudden, in like 1 year, all of this stuff that I've been dealing with an addiction to pornography that started in my life when I was really young and continued to grow in my life into my adult years, my young adult years. And I didn't know how to fight this thing. I didn't know how to defeat it. I knew mentally what I was supposed to do, but I didn't really understand it. I didn't have a revelation, the Bible says. That's where the Holy Spirit reveals something to you, and it's like a light bulb goes off, and you've heard it said a million times over, but now it just means something to you, and it changes the way that you live. That hadn't happened to me yet, about the Word of God and how it could change my thought life and change the way I think, which changes the way that I live. So I was in this cycle of addiction, and it blew up in my life, and I began to open up to my wife about it, and we began to talk. And I had no clue that at that exact same time, my wife was dealing with depression and anxiety attacks. And here we are, 4 years into marriage, and we had done so good at keeping these things hidden from one another. We both loved Jesus. We both went to church. We both were involved in ministry, full-time ministry. And we both wanted to change, but we were still bound in these cycles. And right around that time, by the grace of God, we begin to hear this phrase, meditating on the Word of God. I had heard it my whole childhood, but I didn't really know what it meant. I thought it meant like cross your legs, do your fingers, and go, I didn't know what it meant. I was like, that's weird. That's like yoga. I don't do that. And then I heard one of my spiritual mentors, said it this way. He said, if you know how to worry, you know how to meditate. Worrying is meditating on Satan's promise for our life. The Bible says that Jesus said, Satan comes to steal, to kill, and to destroy. So when I'm worrying, it's really simple what we're doing when we worry. I'm landing the plane here, okay? Hold on. So when we worry, it's really simple what we're doing. We're taking our imagination and our creativity, and we're imagining every terrible possible outcome of this situation we're dealing with. Let's say you just lose your job, right? And so all of a sudden you're worrying, thinking in a thought pattern over and over, going, well, oh my gosh, I'm not going to be able to pay my phone bill now. They're going to shut my phone off. I'm not going to be able to pay my car note. They're going to come take my repossess my car, take my car away. They're going to evict me out of my apartment. I'm not going to be able to pay my bills. I'm going to wind up homeless. My so-and-so in my family is poor too, and I'm going to wind up poor just like the rest of my family. And what happens is you start spinning out of control, and we don't even know what we're doing in that moment, but we're meditating on Satan's promise because Satan wants me to be poor. Satan wants to come and destroy. And so what happens is if I do that long enough, your meditation becomes real. It becomes substance. And the Bible says the opposite of God's nature is fear. So it produces an atmosphere of fear. And fear does different things to different people. To some of you, it might manifest in addiction. To some people, it might be anxiety or depression or all sorts of things. But the Bible says fear is the opposite of God's plan for our life because it has to do with punishment. And there is no punishment in God's love. There's no punishment for us in Christ Jesus. Jesus took the punishment so that we could be saved, set free, delivered, made whole, kept safe and sound, totally whole. So the opposite's true about the Word of God. When we meditate on the Word of God, you take one scripture that combats the lie you're facing. So if you're dealing with anxiety attacks that deal with fear, then just find scriptures, one or two scriptures. You don't need to read the whole Bible. Just take two or three scriptures that talk about the peace of God that surpasses all understanding. And take this scripture and meditate on this scripture with the Holy Spirit. So here's what you do. You take your creativity and your imagination. You take this Word of God, this beautiful promise for you in Christ Jesus. And you ask the Holy Spirit, say, Holy Spirit, you are the Spirit of truth. Jesus said that He would remind you of every word I've spoken to you. Paul said, God doesn't desire to write the Word with ink on tablets of stone, but He wants to write His word or His thoughts by the Spirit of God on the tablet of your heart or your mind. See, that's why we need the Holy Spirit. Without Him, the best I can do is memorize it, and that's a good thing. But the life-changing part comes when I use the Word of God as a tool of intimacy with God. I sing it. You can sing the Word of God. I know the thoughts and the plans you have for me, Jesus. Plans to give me a future and a hope. Plans that I would prosper and not fail. That I would live and not die. You can sing the Word of God. You can say the Word of God over yourself. Make it personal. Jeremiah 29:11. God, I thank You. I know the thoughts that You have for me. God plans to give me a future and a hope. Plans that I would live and not die. Plans that I would prosper, not fail. Thank You, God. Change the way I think today about myself. Let me think the way You think about me, God. Give me Your thoughts about my life, about my future, about my desires and my dreams, my passions, my family. And you just begin to use the Word of God as a conversational tool with God. And as you do that, whether you write the Word of God, you can write it, say it, sing it, think it. As you do it, the Holy Spirit, by faith, starts to write the Word of God on the tablet of your heart. And it's like light bulbs start to go off. The Word comes alive to you. So here's a really simple practice I want to leave you with. I want to show you this scripture. It's in Deuteronomy. Do we have that scripture? Deuteronomy 11, verse 18. So this is when God gave His word to the children of Israel. This is what He told the parents to do with the Word of God. He said, "You shall therefore lay these words of mine in your heart," or in your mind, "and in your soul," your mind, your will, and your emotions. "And you shall bind them as a sign on your hand, and they shall be as frontlets between your eyes. Next verse. You shall teach them to your children, talking of them when you are sitting in your house, when you are walking by the way, when you lie down, and when you rise up. The four most contemplative areas of your day. Your day looks a little bit different than mine. We do different things. We have different passions. We work different jobs. But there's four things that are the same about your day that are mine. You lie down at night. You wake up in the morning. When you get in your car and you're going from point A to point B. And number four, when you've got maybe four or five minutes with nothing to do and you're just seated somewhere. Maybe you're on break at work. You've got a few minutes of downtime. Those four areas of your day are the deep thinking parts of your day. If you can make the practice or the heavenly habit, you see, we can't just stop doing things. We have to fill those negative things we were doing with a heavenly habit. You see, I didn't realize that what was happening in my old life with this addiction that was going out of control is that in the morning when I wake up, instead of meditating on the Word of God, I was scrolling on Instagram. And then I didn't know, but I was sowing seeds into the next chapter of my day. And then at lunchtime, when there was nothing to do, I was on my phone, on Facebook, or I was on YouTube. And over the course of the day, the Bible says you can sow into yourself or you can sow into the Spirit. And from the Spirit of God, you'll reap everlasting life. That's what you're doing when you're meditating on the Word of God. You're sowing into God, and from God, you're reaping life. And the Bible says, if you don't give up at a proper time, you will receive a harvest. So now I know when I lie down at night, I have a choice. The Bible says that there are some things that are, not everything is bad, but not all things are beneficial. So it's probably not bad for me to read the news on my phone or to scroll on Instagram. Not necessarily. But it's not necessarily beneficial to renewing my mind. When I scroll Instagram, my mind isn't renewed. I don't know about you. When I get in that political debate with somebody on Facebook, I don't feel a lot better about myself. I don't know about you guys. Maybe you guys are different. Maybe you walk away from a political debate on Facebook or in the comment section on Instagram and you just feel solid. You feel great. Makes the rest of your day great. But not for me. Now I know that when I lay my head down at night, half of your life is spent dreaming. Why not fall asleep meditating on the Word of God? I used to get mad at myself for falling asleep when I'd read my Bible until I had my baby girl. I don't get mad at my baby girl for falling asleep in my arms. God doesn't get mad at you for that. So I fall asleep at night meditating on the Word of God, and guess what it does? It's sowing seeds into the morning when I wake up, or into 3 a.m. when I wake up out of a dead sleep. For some of us who have anxiety attacks or depression, that 3 in the morning, 4 in the morning, when you wake up in the midnight hour, that's the time when your thoughts are spinning. But you just spent all evening meditating on the Word of God, on one or two promises of how God thinks about you. And you're reaping a harvest when you wake up. He starts to change the way you think, and it changes your whole life. So here's my challenge to you. We'll end it here, landing the plane. My challenge to you is to take two or three scriptures, the Word of God, or the two or three thoughts from the mind of God about you, what He thinks about you in your life. And take these scriptures that combat the lie that you're facing. Because every day we wake up, we got truth or lie. There's no in between. Just the truth or the lie. And so take the truth, the mind of God, and the Word of God that combats the lie that you're facing. And begin to meditate on that Word of God. in all of your deep thinking areas of your day, when you lie down at night, when you wake up in the morning, when you're going from point A to point B, except don't look at your phones when you drive. In the name of Jesus, do not do that. I did not tell you to do that. Throw on your audio Bible. Let it go while you're driving. Be aware. And when you're seated with nothing to do, I promise you, within 2 to 3 days, rapidly, you're going to start seeing a change in your life. This is what sanctification means, becoming more like God. And it's something amazing happens supernaturally when you begin to set your mind on things in heaven where Christ is seated. All of a sudden, you can't say things you used to say. And you have a desire to say some things you didn't used to have a desire for. Now you actually have a desire to pray for your enemy. Because that's how God thinks about your enemy. Now you can't gossip about that person that you know really well, because familiarity breeds contempt, and you know this family member or this friend really well, and you know all their faults and their mistakes, and maybe it used to be kind of normal to gossip about this person. Now when somebody starts gossiping about them, for some reason or another, this conviction comes over you, and you can't gossip. But actually what you have a desire to do is to speak positively about that person. And you start being a peacekeeper everywhere you go. Because blessed are the peacekeepers. They're children of the living God. So why don't we stand together across the place? Did this help anybody here tonight? I wanted to leave you with something that has genuinely changed my walk with God. It's changed my thought life. It's changed my whole life from the inside out. I wanted to leave you with something practical that you can do. This atmosphere of the presence of God we feel tonight, it's not just so that we can feel God, but it's so that God can till the soil of our heart and turn it from a stony heart into a tender heart. Good ground, the Bible says. So that the word of God or the thoughts of God might be deposited into your heart and grow from your heart 40, 60, and 100-fold. Change the whole way you live. Amen? Amen.